snake bites. Although they are rarely fatal here in the United States, every year about 100,000 people die worldwide after being bitten by venomous snakes. A California doctor has come up with a way that might lower those numbers. NewsHour special correspondent Spencer Michels has our report and a warning. It contains images that might be disturbing to some viewers.
Oh my God, did you see that?
In India, children sometimes play with venomous snakes like cobras. This one, featured in a YouTube video, may have been defanged. But playing aside, snakes these children encounter in the wild or in agricultural areas can be deadly. In fact, venomous snakes attack more than 2 million people a year in rural parts of India, Asia, Africa, Central and South America. Most of the victims come from poor agricultural areas remote from hospitals. Without timely medical treatment, patients often die. Matt Lewin, an emergency room physician and medical director of King American Ambulance in San Francisco, has used his experience in treating seizures and his training as a neuroscientist to develop a fast-acting treatment for poisonous snake bites. Lewin does much of his science and his snake bite research here at the California Academy of Sciences in San Francisco's Golden Gate Park. He serves as a physician on academy expeditions around the world where the health of scientists is often at risk, sometimes from snake bites. In fact, in 2001, a 38-year-old academy researcher, Dr. Joseph Slawinski, died after being bitten by a small snake while doing field work in Myanmar. Venom from some snakes contains neurotoxins that paralyze the body, including the respiratory system, and Slawinski couldn't get to a hospital before he stopped breathing.
They were more than 24 hours from help, and they were breathing for this poor man down a mountain, taking turns, and they just couldn't sustain it. He was bitten by a crate, which is a highly venomous snake. It could fit in the palm of your hand.
Treating snake bite victims in India is extremely expensive, often more than rural families can afford. To temporarily counteract the neurotoxins in some snakes' venom, doctors often rely on a drug called neostigmine, which is commonly used in surgery.
It's available everywhere in the world. It's heat stable, and it's very inexpensive.
But in the hands of inexperienced people, injecting it into a bite victim could induce heart problems.
In the injectable form or IV form, it's very toxic. It's difficult to handle. So the idea is to develop a formulation that's less toxic, less prone to complications. To get rid of the needle would be a great way to do this.
Lewin says a nasal spray containing neostigmine could be used safely by almost anyone anywhere, unlike the injectable version. He got the idea from his work in the ambulance and the emergency room.
As one of our protocols, we were using nasal sprays to treat the seizures, and so the thoughts came together sort of out of the blue, like in a clear moment, and I thought, wow, would it be cool if we could treat snake bite with a nasal spray?
It would buy valuable time until the hospital could administer antivenom that uses antibodies to treat and neutralize the snake poison.
75% of the patients or more who die from snake bites never get treated in the hospital. If you make it to the hospital, you'll probably do quite well.
Without funding, Lewin and a group of his scientific friends decided they had to prove that nasal spray would actually counteract the neurotoxin-induced paralysis. So Lewin became the guinea pig, while a team of researchers at the University of California, San Francisco, including anesthesiologist Philip Bickler, conducted a four-hour, self-financed experiment.
Can't let the weight of my jaw.
It involved administering an infusion of a curare-like drug to create a controlled and safe state of partial paralysis.
I couldn't see, couldn't move, couldn't talk, I was very weak.
So he developed some blurred vision, then difficulty swallowing, and at the level we were using it, some slight effects on breathing.
Then Dr. Feiner administered the nasal spray. And a few minutes later, I was quite close to normal.
It worked!
It worked.
But it hasn't been proven in humans against actual snake venom.
Now you stay right where you are. I'll move the snake around.
And some scientists say its benefit is limited because it won't work on most North American snakes, especially not the most common ones in this country, which don't inject neurotoxins in their victims. At Stanford University, Director of Emergency Medicine Robert Norris is a snake enthusiast and a former colleague of Lewin's. Here he's wrangling a venomous northern Pacific rattlesnake named Jake. It's a common North American snake.
Neostigmine would have no benefit for a rattlesnake bite. The venom for rattlesnakes is going to cause tissue damage, blood clotting problems, possibly shock, but very rarely does it cause any neurotoxicity at all, which is what neostigmine might help in some cases.
In fact, Norris argues the venom from most snakes throughout the world are not affected by neostigmine.
I think it's a noble idea. Unfortunately, I don't think it's going to have a great impact. The percentage of snake bites that it would be applicable to is pretty small. And whether or not it would even be effective in those types of snakes is still questionable as well.
But Lewin and his colleague Bickler disagree, and they add that the spray is just a first step towards solving a large problem.
Neostigmine specifically addresses the venom of snakes like cobras that paralyze the muscles. And that alone would have a major impact in terms of the number of victims worldwide who die from snake bites. The paralytic snake bites are the vast majority of the deaths that occur.
Since statistics on snake deaths are spotty, it's hard to tell who is right. Lewin and others are working on that problem and on finding a drug or combination of drugs, a universal antidote that would counteract various kinds of venom, either administered by nasal spray or by an EpiPen that is common for getting relief from allergies.
Well, that's obviously the holy grail, but there's nothing out there right now that looks like it would even potentially fit that definition.
One thing Norris and Lewin do agree on is that because it is not a major problem in the U.S. and Europe, there is far too little attention or research going into snake bites and their treatment.
If you can take it, read more about the research to save lives affected by snake bites. Spencer details that in a blog on our health page.